Okay, so today I'm mainly going to about entrepreneurs that are in Colombia. And I think that all of them are interesting. Like the first one is Vitalana, Ana's project. Ana is related to this one. And then the other one is about the transition problems with one. And let me start from the beginning. This is a project with Álvaro from the University of Sevilla. And his PhD, Lucas Navata, was one of the guys presenting this data analysis thing. So, as you probably know, digital analog is a quantum computing paradigm in which we combine the robustness of analog computing with the.
Sorry, we need to prepare to be like. Ah, sorry, one.
Yeah, the problem is that it's very difficult to read it.
Yeah, no, this is not supposed to be read. This is.
So we don't expect anybody to read the slides.
Yes.
If you have their normal
You just need to read the big.
Please turn on the lights.
Okay, so I was saying that we have the robustness of analog computing with the abilities of designing many things with digital, such as quantum error correction stuff. So, combining these two, we have digital analog. However, there was one of the many problems that. If we wanted to simulate arbitrary Hamiltonian with an arbitrary cross, we have to go step by step, first going through this set is in Hamiltonian. And this requires a cubic amount of analog blocks for these steps. So we thought that maybe we can find a way of simulating this with digital analog. So we start learning from this physical paper from where they propose a schedule for the set Hamiltonian and many other things, but specifically this schedule. So we explain the proposal for general techniques, in particular for point-to-point systems, where we have quadratic amounts of coupling. And the idea was that what we wanted to do was to simulate a Hamiltonian with also a physical Hamiltonian as a resource. And for this, we want
Sorry, can you the motivation once again? Your first slide.
The motivation is the idea is that we want to improve the original proposal for simulating arbitrary Hamiltonians with also another arbitrary Hamiltonian. Because before, this is required a big amount of steps because you have to go through the fixed Hamiltonian. So this step make the procedure little bit, or we saw that it was little bit slow, and maybe it would be
slow as this.
Slow in terms of the number of analog blocks.
So the number within the original method is an standard tension power.
So you needed a huge amount of these blocks sandwiched by single gates. So
So analog blocks are not designed
in these analog blocks are starting evolution through the. I mean, this case is just. But in general, the analog blocks will be the evolution under the source Hamiltonian. So you have to make rotations that start to work with sets Hamiltonians and then use this to simulate general salutary function. What to worry?
What's it called? Like, I have no idea. Why did they actually do things?
Right.
Main principle to
right. You come to us, Luca, Enrique, Michel, but it's because you have digital part, so as the single communication and then the analog part, as just having a system evolving freely without any input to the system.
How do you combine these two? Yes, possibly.
Okay.
Maybe we can go further with Miguel though. Next week I will say like it's super important to what if you want. If not, we can give us.
It's better to have this kind of questions. So
the players.
So now the only thing that you need to know is that we have signaling gates, sandwiching analog blocks. And we wanted to reduce the number of these blocks. So in the original work, I will probably explain. What they propose is to apply a couple of X gates to each of the pairs in the system. So this effectively changes the sign of the catalyst, where only one X gate is applied. We have a coupling, and if we apply one X gate to one of the two qubits, then it will change the sign, but if we apply two X gates to both of the qubits, nothing will happen. So this generates this kind of nice sequence, and making some calculations and stuff, you have that in order to recover or in order to simulate any sensor Hamiltonian with another arbitrary sensor Hamiltonian, AC Hamiltonian, you need to solve this kind of linear system of equation, which was proven that you can solve it because this M matrix is non-invertible. It's non-singular, except for n equal 4. It's not a problem, but it can be solved really easily. And in this case, in the case where we have a set or let's say mu is in Hamiltonians, all the terms in the Hamiltonian commute with each other, so we don't have any trotterization error system because since they are commutes, the trotter formula is exact in this case.
You need to go from an arbitrary Hamiltonian to the set set?
No, in this case, if you go from the set set, from an arbitrary set set Hamiltonian to another arbitrary set set Hamiltonian, you don't have any trotter error.
I mean, you change the coefficients.
You want to simulate a Hamiltonian with so choppy G's and you use the H's and then you play around with this protocol and you can speak. So this requires n squared amount of digital analogs. So in order to solve our problem about using an arbitrary solved Hamiltonian to simulate evolution under an arbitrary Hamiltonian, we thought about using the same idea. So the idea is that now we are going to select all a couple of qubits in the system without repeating. So this looks exactly the same as before, but now this is true. And now we are running all the possible combinations of single qubit gates. So having the first and second qubit, we apply x on both, x1, y2, and blah blah blah, until we complete all the 9 possible combinations.
Why do you have x's?
Here, x.
No. First qubit after the.
Ah, okay, yeah, sorry. This should be here. My mistake. I just copy from the. So, yeah, imagine that instead of applying it here, we apply it here, but imagine if this is here instead. So, okay, now we change the effective sign of some of the coupling, because here we are assuming that all the terms that we have are bounding terms, two-body bounding terms. So, we have here x1 and x2. And before the matrix had some properties with the set case, which gave you that the matrix is not singular. In this case, the proof that this new protocol generates an invertible matrix is a little bit more involved. And the proof is not interesting, but the general idea is that you can divide this matrix in block. You can use the formal determinant, which is, I think, a powerful tool, because the determinant of a matrix can be obtained as the determinant of the formal determinant of a matrix. And what is the formal determinant of a matrix? So if you have a block matrix, so these are 9x9 matrices, but can be any square matrix, all of the same size. What you can do is treat this block matrix as a matrix in which each of the elements was a number, and then you can compute the determinant as the usual way, with all the possible combinations of rows and columns. And once you have done this, then you just have to compute the determinant of a 9x9 matrix. So if you face these kind of problems, this is a useful tool. And then once we did this, we can employ some modular arithmetic to finally prove that this the determinant is non-zero. However, in this case, we have a problem. The throttle formula doesn't work. It works, but it produces an error, because now the terms in the different Hamiltonians don't commute with each other. The effective Hamiltonian with the effective signs change doesn't commute with each other, so we produce an error, and this error grows exponentially with the modulus of the Hamiltonian, and with the time of the total time that it takes to simulate this, the total time where you have to run the sim. So this new scheme, I didn't put it here, but basically just needs a quadratic amount of steps. In fact, it's about 9 times longer than the protocol for the set. So it's quadratic and is exactly the fastest that you can do it in order to, for general Hamiltonians, is the fastest that you can do it. You cannot do it with less amounts of analog blocks. So we thought, okay, this grows well, but for small systems, you still have to simulate, or you still have many different analog blocks. So what if we try to achieve the same? So use arbitrary Hamiltonian to simulate a formal arbitrary Hamiltonian. But now, instead of employing a systematic protocol, let's use a classical optimization protocol Tu try to do the same with less mathematics. The idea we talked about is this kind of process in which we have a problem, so we have a short Hamiltonian, a problem Hamiltonian and a time, and we want to fix a number of analog loss to what is here. Example 5, or whatever. Now what we do is to parameterize the circuit as the typical Bequi-Alstab where we leave each circuit gate to have any possible rotational angle and rotational axis. So we have here the three parameters, and then we can also leave or not, I will talk about this later, the time for the analog loss. So with the parametric fitment, we evaluate it with an approximation that really, if you already know which evolution you want to simulate and use that to train your circuit, you will get the best results. But that makes no sense because you already knew the expression. So we have to find a way of not cheating, and the way of not cheating is just this Trotter approximation, this Trotterization of the circuit in order to obtain a cheap simulation, a classical simulation of the system. Also, here we have the target evolution that we want to simulate, and okay, we cannot have this, so let's use an approximation. This is exactly the same in both cases, when we trotterize over each two-body term. With this, we evaluate the appropriate distance. We would have to use any other distance, but the appropriate distance is easy to evaluate and gives you good results. And then, with this, we make a Bayesian optimization, we employ a Bayesian optimization algorithm in order to obtain a new set of parameters and repeat this loop until we are happy with the result. So, I mean, that.
There's a question there. So, is it really easy to open this thing?
No,
no. The distance.
Yeah, because it's just an N-square operation, because you have to just sum the difference between each of the elements. So, it's easy to evaluate. For operators, when you are dealing with states, then you have many possible ways to see the clarity. But here we are only targeting the unitary of the circuit. So we have many disorder. We also have about using other
instances. It's a few more.
Sorry, yes. Yeah, because we could have to use the infinity.
No, it's
so this optimization is a global optimization only.
Yes.
And gradient free optimization.
Yes.
And do we have access to gradient when we do this?
We don't have gradient because if we want to obtain the derivative of this kind of will get really messy, really, really quickly. So, we try a optimization method that doesn't need the gradient.
But we have it, it will get messy, but in principle, we should have it.
Yeah, we should have it, but it's. You can't compute it, but. The idea is that you want to do an optimization that is also cheap to do classically. You don't need to. So if you are spending 2 weeks of computing in a super computer, then why bother running and not
Okay.
And what's the idea of the Bayesian optimization?
Yes.
Ah.
Yeah, I have the idea because I didn't even know.
Before that, I think that the Frobenius distance is not the best. Because in general, you are just over asking.
Why? Because you are applying the tribute to zero, 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 zero. So here, any norm, you are implementing any norm, you are implementing this by when it was mistake. However, you are not applying this to any possible
mistake. I mean, then
the second option to optimize a much more efficient implementation is to use scalar plot between zero and zero of identity minus. You target the other, you steer it. Because if they are equal, this is just possibility and zero. And if they are different, it's always applied to the so this.
Yeah,
in my
that requires matrix multiplication.
Or not necessarily.
Matrix vector, matrix vector multiplication.
Which is quite cheap, you know, in comparison with matrix. And this will all give you, because as you are supplied with zero always, when you do the comparison, it does optimize in the section of the kilo space that is the optimal for you.
Yeah. This is, I think, asking a little bit too much, but okay, might be useful when you are not applying it. To the CBCFT because maybe you just want the digital analog circuit for a block in a bigger algorithm. So we thought that maybe this maintains the idea of using this as a block. This block in digital analog to this operation, we are sure that we are close to the target operation. Okay, so this is just some heuristic selection of what we are doing here, also the concentration of the circuit. But I think it's good enough for this point. So, okay, about the logistic optimization, the idea is that you use this kind of logistic optimization when your cost function is really costly to provide. So each of these points takes a lot of resources. So the idea is that you want a gradient-free optimization because if you want to compute the gradient, then you can compute it numerically with points next to one point and you can evaluate the derivative there, the numerical derivative, but that takes a lot of time because you need more points. So again, okay, let's try to obtain the original function using the fewer evaluations possible.
So you're reconstructing the landscape?
Yeah, you are going to reconstruct. Yes, because your idea, what you want is, for example, you want to maximize, in this case, we want to minimize the cost function rules, would be this one. To minimize this.
And this is really cheaper than reading this. If you want the global minimum, if you can define with a local minimum, then yes, reading this is cheaper, right?
It depends on the number of hyperparameters you want to optimize. In this case, the amount of hyperparameters we have is 3. Because of the angles, times n because of the qubits, times k because of the number of theta analog blocks. So we have a really big amount of hyperparameters to optimize. So if you want to evaluate the gradient, you need to do that amount of evaluation per point to get the. So in this case, it's. We wanted a gradient-free global optimization. So the idea is that we sample from the initial points, almost any global optimization algorithm, and with those points we obtain a supernovid model. And what is a supernovid model? It's a strange thing that I don't understand very well, but you have this Gaussian process model, polynomial regression model, in which you define some models in which you can define a cost function that you think you have And then with these models, you also have some extra information. For example, here you have the amount of information you have for each point. So, in the point where you have already measured, the error that you expect to have is zero. But then in the between the points, you don't really know, you can just guess what do you have.
And then, sorry, which model is this?
Yeah, you can have polynomial or without the this is defined and you can. I didn't really understand well, these models, but the idea is that you can get a guess for your cost function with this. And once you have the minimum model, you evaluate some acquisition function. And acquisition function will give you information about will help you choose the next point to evaluate. You have also some possible options for this, expected improvement, predicted value. I don't really understand it well, but in this case, we use the expected improvement, which gives you information about, okay, which point will give me more information about the model. So where I'm going to maximize the information gain. With this, you can maximize the machine, you select any point and you make any measurement. And then you repeat this until you act with the function that you have approximately. Yeah.
Actually, why do we use a global optimization and not global optimization? Just the fact that we want to go to a global minimum, that's
only. Yeah, because the last thing here. It's not really good. I mean, the starting point of the parameter, we can make a relatively good guess by using the parameters that are given to you by the form. So you trotterize your target vector. So you trotterize this, you can get more or less a guess, a good guess of which parameter you should put here, but you know that this is not going to be optimal because if not, you already solved the problem. So from that point, you start making new guesses. So maybe the starting point is this one, but you don't really know if by doing a gradient descent you will arrive to the best one or the last thing. I don't have the blocks here, but the landscape is really complicated. Many parameters, it's like a little bit messy. And finding the global optimum is. You can find local optima that are good enough, but if you aim improving as much as you can, then you have to go to global optimizers.
Oh, and the starting point is the points that you got from this plotter.
Yes, yes.
So it's kind of warm starting, it's not randomly choosing.
Yes, so one point you already have it because of the plotter, and the rest you can start guessing because obviously if you only have one point, then this acquisition function will be flat over most of the space. Not near the initial point, but over the rest of the space is more or less flat. So the best thing to do is start with some initial
point. So if you do this random initialization without the information of the plotter, you will get like basically a flat curve and at some point it will go down the stream.
Yes. Because once you already choose, you don't need many points, maybe 10 or with this, you can then start evaluating the surrogate model and then the acquisition function.
The acquisition function? So is going to help you choose the model that gives you the more information so to improve the surrogate model, right?
Yes.
Do you think it would be possible to do something that instead of improving like all your surrogate model, improving the parts which are the most likely to be the global minimum? Do you think that's
Okay, so with this, we ran from exposure conditions on a problem which was solved in a previous paper with Tassin and and we find that okay, we have an improvement. So this is the, we call it the error. So the trotter, the schedule done with the trotter formula is pretty bad, and we optimize and we obtain some improvement here. In particular, in the cases where we left the time t as a fixed point, not as a parameter, because the optimization of the optimization algorithm get even worse when we take into account that the time can change. It's expected because the angles of the single wind gate are bounded between 0 to pi, but time is whatever you want. Even if you fix certain ranges of times, the landscape is not the best landscape. So, we got that, and okay, we expect that we can publish something soon. the second project that I'm working on is about optimization problem. In this case, it's not being packing anymore, it's electric vehicle charging and packing problem, which is again a combinatorial optimization problem. And I'm doing this with Alberto from Trento. And the idea is that you have a fleet of vehicles which are electric, and they have to do something, energy. The cost of the energy is not constant during the day, so there are different times of the day where you can charge your bikes or discharge them, and the idea is that you want to minimize the cost of running. The cost of running the bikes. And you will have certain constraints. And okay, this problem was originally proposed for testing that you can do clear away with qubits. And as a test problem, they used this one. Which basically means okay, I want to minimize the cost, so this goes into the cost function. However, I have some restrictions regarding the state of charge of the vehicles. Because they cannot be, a vehicle cannot be at zero energy at some point because it has to move. And then at the end of the day, it has to have a certain amount of charge, has to be. To be used the next day. However, when they propose this, they propose a way of encoding the problems. They get k body terms. In fact, they get n body terms, which is not really good for simulating nor running experiments. So. This was a problem, and another problem is that this original problem just taking into account the cost and the limits on the state of charge, and also the limits on the maximum power that you can work with in each moment, gives you a problem that could be solved with a 3D algorithm. And just taking the optimal cost for one vehicle, then repeat it for all the vehicles, and then if you have some problem, try to fix it by changing it a little. So, this is not a good problem for trying to prove that quantum is good. because classical is already useful. So we need a more difficult problem, but with a reasonable amount of variables and resources. And for this, we thought about including just a little spiciness to the problem in terms of, okay, now I will take into account position. So I have this one in Zaragoza, this one where, this one in whatever, and I want to move them around. And the point at which the bus can stop, can have or not have checking station, and probably you want to go from Oviedo to León, you have to go up, so it will take more energy. So now we have more constraints about the initial and final position, the energy cost of moving, and the charging stations. So now the problem is a little bit more difficult. It's a little bit more difficult, but we still are going to be able to encode it with a few qubits. And as really here, I will use again the highly complex aspect production of VC to solve this problem. Why? Because we can treat each of the cards independently and then make generate two solutions from the, putting together solutions from different cards. So for the ones who haven't been here last year, we made a heuristic in which we could solve combinatorial optimization problems, dividing the constraints, combinatorial optimization problems, dividing the constraints into two. Partial constraints and global constraints. Why? Because usually when you try to solve a global optimization problem in a material one, you just enforce all the constraints at the same time and you just run any algorithm that you can think about. However, if you want to do that in quantum, encoding all the constraints and leaving this path with quantum takes a lot of resources. Terms of qubits, dealing with them, whatever. So if we do this division of the of partial and global constraints, what we get is a smaller problem for the quantum device that it can be solved efficiently or it can be solved reasonably well in a quantum computer, and then evaluate the more difficult constraints for the quantum computer. For the quantum computer, classic. So we divide this into two steps. First, we obtain partial solutions. We sample them with a quantum algorithm, and from this set of feasible partial solutions, we put them together with a cheaper classical algorithm. And we can make feasible solutions easily and hopefully optimal. So in this case, if we want to encode the full problem, we need to take into account the state of charge of our vehicles, the position of our vehicles at all times, and it gets really messy and really quick. However, if you only want to solve for one bug, one problem, you can use a linear amount of qubits. In this case, we just need 3 qubits for each time step. Here what we will plot is the state of charge, the charging status, so if a car is charging or discharging, and the position. And now when we want to encode the constraints of our problem, we found that this kind of encoding for the variable gives you a cheaper way of encoding the constraints. In this case, we need k-mod interactions, but as you see here, we only need 2 times of 3-mod interactions and 1 time of 4-mod interactions, which scales really good. So So then we this encoding we use it for with aqua to algorithm. We thought about using annealing, we thought about using QRA, but for the moment we just tested programs in this way. But this is a step of solving the partial problem can be done in many different ways. But yeah, I propose to use Grover as a first approach. And for this, an interesting thing that we found is that usually Grover is for finding one element in n-dimensional neural space. But sometimes you can have k targets. So when you have k targets, you may know that you don't need just the square root of n, but the square root of n divided by 3. If you know the number of targets, if you don't know how many solutions you have in the problem, you have to find it in a blind limit. But there was a paper from 1996. Where they proposed a strategy, it's called tight bound for searching many objects in quantum, blah blah blah. And they found an algorithm, a classical searching algorithm, which gives you really relatively good bound for how many times you need to run your circuit. I'm not talking about the number of Oracle calls, but runs, complete runs. So with this, you can more or less find it quickly. However, this paper only took into account that you want one solution. But if you want all the solutions, it's not really optimal. So, for example, here I'm showing that I want to find all the k equals 6 elements in a really big neural space. So if I use this tight bound paper, you more or less can be quickly compared with another strategy. If you use all the time the square root of k, you in this case you find solutions quickly because it's so small that the number of Oracle calls that you need to make is more or less for this case. So we propose a new strategy which is more or less related to the time bounds. And basically, what we do is I want one solution. How many times will I run the how many Oracle calls it will do for the Grover? I know that the maximum amount is this square root. So I will start. I have two strategies in which I will increase the number of Oracle calls in the different rounds until I hit the maximum, then I will hold up. Do this kind of searching over how many Oracle calls do I need to find a solution. This is the limited one. And we can do the same but in the other direction. So assuming that I have a low amount of solution, so my input to start coming from a square root of n. And for you to know that the time bounds algorithm, they define a straight line, and they did what they did is make a uniform sample. So they randomly choose over these rates. So in you see it from really far, you can see that they are more or less exactly the same strategy, but this is kind of deterministic, and the other one just relies on the how good you can uniformly sample the solutions. Okay, so as a test, what we did is to keep the same amount of the three dimensions for the Hilbert space, but now we increase the number of possible solutions, and we find that here that the vanilla version of the Rover algorithm, so with always square root of n, quickly gives you really bad results. And it takes a long time to obtain all the solutions to the problem. But as you can see, as we increase the number of solutions to our problems, here we are trying to find 5,000 solutions on this different space, we see that the heuristic in which, but the heuristic in which they start increasing the number of oracle calls gives you almost always better results than the type bound one. And this, you can see, there is kind of a phase transition in which the type bound strategy works really bad, and the rest of the two stays more or less the same until at some point they cross. Because here we are expecting almost. So we want a number of solutions that is only half of the Hilbert space dimension, so it's really nice. Talking with Peter yesterday, he proposed me a good way of measuring how good a strategy can be is see the how fast to sample in the beginning. So maybe a good way of addressing how well these strategies work is to have the derivative at the initial at zero or less to know how fast you start sampling, because in this case, the case where we are searching many possible solutions, or the fraction of solution is to be probably random sampling will work as good as any of these two, as any of these three strategies. So maybe it would be a good idea to just start random sampling until some point. But this is so future work that we have to do. And okay, we tested this on a toy problem in which we have this kind of graph with just four bands. These roads, some example roads that can be traversed, and if they take the road from 1 to 4, they cost more energy, which is probably a non-significant cost of the energy. But with this toy problem, we just wanted to test that something with this problem would be good enough. And then we, for the global solution, we propose a new way of generating full solution, which is a biased sampling or a greedy sampling of the solution, which is good because we obtain a second best solution. So good enough. But we still have a lot of work to do. And we will. Hopefully we will publish the preliminary results on September or some conference, but the full work will be more involved, because the main idea for Alberto from Trento is to know how to use qubits for solving optimization problems. And this is not trivial here.
Just a small question. The Hamiltonian for this is n local.
It's not, I mean, can't think about it as Ah, set is in Hamiltonian because these problems are all classical.
All classical, yeah.
However, okay, when you are dealing with qubits, it's easy because you, for generating any diagonal term, you can just put single body set term, two body set terms, three body, blah, blah, blah. Here we are working with qubits, and then it's more difficult to generate Hamiltonians. So yeah, this is one of the things that we are working on, because with qubits, the operator, the natural operators of your system are not anymore like the Pauli basis, they are in a strange basis, and depends also in the hardware. So yeah, this is one of the things that we have to think about.
And can you go to the cost function? Yeah, what does it tell you here, capital N?
Capital N is some state of some state. Yeah, but it's basically depends on the cost factor, depends only on this line. Because it's where you are buying energy and selling energy to the grid. So really the cost function only depends here. The rest of the variables are for the cost. But in this case, using this encoding, the Hamiltonian, for encoding the cost function is local. So it's really good because we only need local terms in each of these units.
Oh.
So instead of this crazy embody terms, embody qubit terms, it's difficult to remember.
Yeah. More questions? Okay.